to the motherfucking relay. We're covering today's top boxing news.
Okay, we'll start with this. Some unfortunate news in the women's junior middleweight division. April Hunter took to her social media and stated, "Writing this with a heavy heart. The fight is off. Terrible few days of my life, just getting worse. Wednesday I damaged my elbow badly in my final spar, thought adrenaline would get me through on the night, so I still came as I wanted to fight. Unfortunately, today, on my medical, I tried to hide my elbow from the doctor, but the examination was too thorough and he spotted it and has said I'm not fit to fight. Gutted. Hopefully, nothing too serious and I will be back in the ring ASAP. Sorry to my family and friends who paid to be there. I thought I'd be able to still pull this off. Maybe shouldn't have even flown out here, but you never know until you know. Surely things got to go good from now on. Big thank you to my sponsors who stand by me through thick and thin. It's been a challenging 12 months. April Hunter was supposed to be facing Canada's own Mary Spencer.
This was supposed to be for a lesser version of the WBA title, a WBA gold title.
I think Terry Harper is still registered as that division's WBA champion, though we all know she's not going to be campaigning as a junior middleweight moving forward. Thus, the full title may be up for grabs, and this fight was supposed to be a step in that direction, but as you can see, April Hunter has fallen ill, injured, I should say, and she's not going to be fighting Mary. Perhaps this is for the best.
Maybe.
Perhaps she dodged a bullet, because I think Mary was going to brutalize her. I think Mary was going to knock her out, like she knocked out Chris Namis, like she knocked out Cynthia Lozano. She was going to knock out April.
Oh, yeah.
The only woman to ever beat Mary Spencer was a more experienced fighter in Femke Hermans, a multi-weight champion. And needless to say, April Hunter is nowhere near as battle-tested as Femke Hermans.
So even though Femke made Mary look really bad and really limited in their two fights, April Hunter is not of that ilk. She neither has the power or the pedigree to keep Mary Spencer off of her. So perhaps it's for the best that she's not going through with this fight.
The sad part is she pulled out right before the fight. It was supposed to go down tomorrow, so I don't even think there's enough time to find a late replacement for Mary Spencer to fight someone else for that WBA gold title.
That's the sad part, that this happened at the very last minute.
Ranked ahead of Mary Spencer in the current WBA rank standings is the Dominican Republic's own Claribel Mina.
She's ranked at number 2.
Former undisputed welterweight champion Cecilia Brakes. She's ranked at number 1. Perhaps Mary Spencer may end up fighting one of them at some point this year for what could be the newly vacated WBA title. Now you understand that Mary Spencer, she is up there in age, and she has her limitations as a fighter, she does, but it takes certain ingredients to deal with her that I don't think every girl has. No, her overwhelming size and aggression and punching power, her pedigree.
She can be beaten. We know that she can be beaten, but not by just anybody.
It's gotta be frustrating for Mary, so close to fight night, to have this happen, because the camp was completed and all the work was done.
But I still believe in this fighter. I still believe Mary Spencer can become a world champion at 154. She can do it!
She just needs the opportunity. She just needs the chance. The only hope now is that the good people at Eye of the Tiger Management, who schedule a lot of shows, they do a lot of shows up there in Canada, north of the border, can get Mary out there sometime over the summer months, that she might be able to squeeze in at least 2 more fights with what remains of this year, and that at least one of those fights could be for that WBA title that seems to be up for grabs. I'm holding out hope that things work out for Mary. Elsewhere in the world of boxing, the World Boxing Council requests more information from Ryan Garcia before continuing their own investigation. I'm not sure to what extent they're involved or they're supposed to be, as Ryan Garcia is not a WBC champion. He's not in possession of any WBC titles, interim or silver.
You're doing too much, man.
The World Boxing Council has requested further information from Ryan Garcia regarding his failed drug tests for his fight with Devin Haney. Garcia, 25, came in overweight and therefore was ineligible to win the sanctioning body's super lightweight title that Haney was defending for the first time in April at the Barclays Center in Brooklyn, New York. He proceeded to repeatedly hurt his previously undefeated opponent and recorded knockdowns in the 7th, 10th and 11th rounds in the process of earning a majority decision. It was then reported that he had tested positive for the banned substance, Asterin.
Ryan didn't win the title, so what's the extent of the WBC's involvement? Ryan is not WBC champion.
Ryan Garcia, who's repeatedly claimed he didn't cheat. We have consistently maintained Ryan was a victim of supplement contamination.
No, you didn't. Ryan tried to blame this on Victor Conti and the Haney's.
This is just your latest excuse, that Ryan was the victim of supplement contamination and has never intentionally used any banned or performance-enhancing substances. His legal team even more recently said, Asterin has been on the banned list of the World Anti-Doping Agency since 2008, and in 2022 was listed by the agency as an anabolic agent, as it has been widely publicized around the world. Read the statement from the World Boxing Council. The contents of Ryan Garcia's A and B sample containers collected on April 19th and April 20th of this year yielded adverse analytical findings for Asterin. Asterin is a selective androgen receptor modulator, a SARM. Asterin and all SARMs are banned substances at all times under the World Boxing Council's Clean Boxing Program. Upon receiving the notification of the adverse findings, the World Boxing Council immediately started its result management's process. Under the governing WBC Clean Boxing Program's testing and results management guidelines, under that process, the World Boxing Council notified Mr. Garcia of the adverse findings, provided him with information about his right to witness the opening of the B sample container, and to have the contents of the B sample container tested. The B sample container's contents also yielded adverse analytical findings for Asterin.
Yeah, now tell me something I don't know.
In addition to the World Boxing Council's result management unit's notification to Mr. Garcia, requested available information and or documents to assist the unit's determination of the circumstances leading or reasonably related to the adverse findings. The World Boxing Council's result management unit anticipates receiving the available information requested toward the end of June. In the meantime, the World Boxing Council has continued to investigate the pharmacological characteristics of Asterin, the details of the test results that led to the adverse findings, and any other explanation that might relate to the adverse findings. The WBC will continue to provide updates of the process it is undertaking.
For what?
It's not like Ryan Garcia has an alphabet title of any kind that you can strip him from, and it's not like you can absolve him, you can exonerate him, you can't.
What the fuck can you do?
Understand that the only ones with teeth here, the only ones with any power to either suspend Ryan Garcia or otherwise, is the New York State Athletic Commission, not the World Boxing Council, that for anyone looking to fight in the great state of New York City, you gotta go through the local commission. You know, they're the ones that give you a boxing license, and they're the ones that can suspend you. The World Boxing Council.
You're conducting an investigation for what? To do what?
I don't see any other sanctioning body, quite like the WBC, meddling in affairs that don't really even involve them.
Not the WBA, the WBO, or the IBF. No, they don't crash other people's parties like the WBC does. Consider that for Gervonta Davis's upcoming fight with Frank Martin, the WBC have taken it upon themselves to manufacture a Juneteenth belt.
Bear in mind that neither Gervonta Davis or Frank Martin are in possession of any WBC titles. No, that fight is for Gervonta Davis's WBA title, and yet the WBC is still choosing to get involved.
Manufacture a belt.
The belt in and of itself doesn't come with any kind of status. It's little more than just a novelty, a commemorative item to commemorate the fight. But what the fuck do they need you manufacturing belts to commemorate their fight? WBA titles on the line, they don't need you.
In that situation.
And no one needs you in this one. Involving Ryan Garcia. This is between Ryan, the New York State Athletic Commission,
the two supplement manufacturers he claims the Asterin may have come from.
So what's your role in all of this? What are you supposed to be doing? You can't clear Ryan Garcia if that's what you've got in your head.
That's what you're trying to do.
You don't have the power to do that. The say-so.
You don't.
And what this sounds like is pointless busy work from an entity that is not otherwise involved, that can't reach any kind of adjudication on the matter and have any palpable effect.
Fuck off.
Now, I don't know what the WBC is trying to do here. I just know that they can't exonerate Ryan, they can't absolve him, they can't save him, and they can't condemn him.
Whatever they bring to the table is purely anecdotal.
And finally, in men's heavyweight news, Eddie Hearn, on the heels of Deontay Wilder's latest defeat, says...
Wilder.
Deontay is not the same fighter that he was.
Maybe not.
Wilder's just not the same, in all honesty, Hearn told Fight Hub TV. I just feel his belief is not there anymore, and you've got to ask yourself, why? Is it just the time? Is something else not right? He is not letting his hands go, and that is what made him one of the most feared fighters in the world. He is not the fighter that he was at the moment. People come back, but it is deep in the road.
I disagree.
Disagree with what?
Even in his prime, even in his younger years, Wilder would spend the majority of the round, the majority of a fight, looking to land a single punch. He was never really a combination puncher.
Or all that prolific within a round. Wilder, 38, went on record before the fight with Zhang saying that retirement was a very realistic option if he was to lose. He's lost 4 of his last 5 fights, and it looks almost certain that he will retire after a highly entertaining career. He helped revitalize the American heavyweight boxing scene and delivered brutal knockouts that followers of boxing crave. Hearn thinks that although Wilder may never have beaten the elite fighters in his era, he will still be remembered fondly by fans for his entertaining style and his famous trilogy with Fury. He was a world champion, Hearn said. He had a lot of defenses. He lit up the heavyweight division. He didn't have very many wins against elite-level guys, but he had some good wins and was exciting. He had some great fights with Tyson Fury, so he will be remembered. But with no victories over elite competition, no victories over his contemporaries.
In this era or the previous one?
How should he be remembered? Far be it for me to tell you what to feel and what to think. I can only tell you what I think.
That's it.
And if you want to know what I think, and you're here, so I'll assume that you do.
I don't think that Wilder's now the fighter that he used to be. He can't throw with the same confidence, with the same conviction. I think that much is true. He's not who he was. But even when he was who he wasn't that good then either.
When he threw with more conviction, when he threw with more confidence, even then, I didn't think much of him or his boxing.
Here's an example.
In 2011, unbeaten Tyson Fury took on unbeaten Derek Chisora.
Derek was 14-0 at the time.
And what if I told you that that 14-0 Derek Chisora was better than anybody Wilder was fighting at that time? Wilder fought something like 4 or 5 times that same year in 2011. And look at who he was fighting. Look at who he was keeping busy with.
Journeymen, no-hopers, guys with losses in the double digits of guys who never did anything and didn't go on to do anything.
That's who Wilder was fighting while Tyson Fury was fighting Derek Chisora. I happen to think, if Deontay Wilder would have encountered that version of Derek Chisora, if he would have fought him back then, he wouldn't have made it to the WBC title. He would have never became the WBC champion because Derek would have beat him.
What are you saying?
That even if Deontay Wilder is not the same fighter today that he used to be, even when he was that guy, he wasn't that good.
You're saying you think Derek Chisora would have beat Deontay Wilder?
That's exactly what I'm saying, because a lesser fighter and a lesser man than Derek Chisora already came very close to beating Deontay Wilder. You know who I'm talking about. I'm talking about Harold Skoniers, an undersized heavyweight, a journeyman who knocked Wilder on his ass and, according to reports at the time, knocked Wilder out.
But Wilder was saved by the bell.
If an unheralded, undersized heavyweight, a nobody who nobody remembers did that to you way back when, what would Derek have done to you way back when if you were fighting somebody like him instead of all the stumble bums you ended up fighting? For 7 years and 32 fights? Not becoming of an Olympian, it's not what you expect, because usually it's the Olympians that hit the ground running and get off to a fast start, where Wilder, he didn't.
Eddie Hearn says that Wilder's not the same fighter now that he used to be. And while I do agree with that, I do, even when he was who he was, he wasn't much better back then either.
Two things can be true at the same time. That now, after 4 losses, 3 of them being knockout losses, Wilder just doesn't believe in himself as much as he used to, and maybe he doesn't, but even when he did, his handlers must not have believed in him.
Because look at how they matched him.
Baby soft, if he would have encountered the Derek Chisora that Tyson Fury fought, I think Derek would have beat him. I think the Kubrat Pulev that Vladimir Klitschko fought, I think that Pulev would have beat him. The Povetkin that Klitschko fought, I think that Povetkin would have beat him.
They talk about all the contemporaries and all the elite fighters in this era that Wilder never fought, or that Wilder fought but Wilder never beat. But what about the previous one? They think of this guy as if he's from this era when he's from the Klitschko era.
Not this one. This guy debuted in 2008. So from 2008 to 2015, when he finally does fight for a world title, who the fuck was he fighting in between?
Based on that, how should Wilder be remembered when seemingly, as soon as he stepped up in class, that's as soon as it took him to start losing?
Literally.
Main reason I keep having to go over this, and so many people are still struggling with it, is because they bought into the promotion and Wilder's aura that he's this legendary puncher. Legendary punchers, in a very general sense, have legendary victories. What is Wilder's?
You know, Joe Lewis has got a few. He's got a knockout win over Primo Carnera, Tony Galento, Max Schmeling, James J. Braddock.
Legendary punchers, in a very general sense, have legendary victories.
George Foreman's got a knockout win over Olympic gold medalist and then champion Joe Frazier. Many, many years later, he comes back, he knocks out a younger man in Michael Mora.
Legendary punchers, in a very general sense, have legendary victories. What is Wilder's?
Because the reason that fighters like George Foreman and Joe Lewis are remembered the way they're remembered is because of who they fought, but not just who they fought, who they beat, and who they knocked out.
How it only took Mike Tyson a couple of seconds into the first round to dispatch the same Michael Spinks the Jinx, that went 30 rounds with Larry Holmes, couldn't make it out of the first round with Iron Mike.
The same Iron Mike who also knocked out Larry Holmes, who had never been knocked out up until he fought Mike. This is why these guys are remembered the way they're remembered.
This is why.
Not because of stat padding, a padded resume filled with knockout victories over club fighters and stumble bums.
Show me a version of Wilder that was beating elite level competition, elite fighters, because it seems to me that he didn't do it before and he certainly ain't doing it now.
So how should he be remembered?
You tell me that he's not now the fighter that he used to be. But when I take a closer look at the fighter that he used to be,
even then he wasn't used to elite competition.
Even then, he wasn't beating anybody worth remembering.
Maybe Eddie Hearn didn't want to be hard on Wilder, be harsh on the heels of his latest loss.
And maybe I do. Maybe I am harsh, because I have to be. Someone has to be.
Before all the sweethearts and romantics try to rewrite history about Wilder being this all-time great fighter, I don't think so.